Good morning. I am Nikhil Mittal, and I'm going to talk about continuous integration tools and how their features and misconfigurations could be abused. So we'll talk about continuous intrusion, why CI, that is continuous integration tools, are an attacker's best friends. Starting with some words of wisdom, this is the quote from a military strategist and politician from ancient India. As a single wither tree, if set aflame, causes a whole forest to burn, so does a single improperly configured continuous integration tool destroys a whole enterprise network. And really, words of wisdom, he saw this thing, 2,000 years back. So a couple of things about me. I'm on Twitter, so follow me. I blog on labofapenetrationtester.com. I'm a creator of Cautilia and Nishang. Cautilia is a tool which you can use to ease usage of human interface devices in penetration tests. And Nishang is a tool for using PowerShell in pen testing and offensive security. Both of the tools are available on my GitHub account. I've been a frequent speaker for the past few years at different conferences. In this talk, we are going to discuss a lot of things, and I'm hoping I do not run out of time. We'll see what are continuous integration tools, why they are useful for us. We'll see, hopefully with live demonstrations, to abuse some of the most popular CI tools like Jenkins, TeamCity, Go. No demonstrations for cruise control. It's really old now. Then we'll see a zero-day vulnerability, which everyone is talking about, the Java de-unserialization bug, which was sitting idle for 9 months, no one noticed. And then we'll see a common abuse set for all the CI tools. What is the misconfiguration or common features or design implementations or design flaws which all of the CI tools or most of the CI tools share. Then we'll talk about the defense for users, that is enterprises who deploy CI tools in their environments, and for developers as well. And that's it. We'll also see that what others are doing, what bad guys or others are doing using CI tools. So first of all, what are continuous integration tools? So I picked it up from Wikipedia. Continuous integration describes a set of software engineering practices that speed up the delivery of software by decreasing integration times. Very easy to understand. Software that accomplishes this practice is called continuous integration software, or a CI tool. So CI tools were used just to decrease the time of integrating code of different developers. It helps build teams, source code management teams, developers. This is a typical implementation, a very simplified implementation of continuous integration in an enterprise. There are developers who make code changes to code repositories. There are build teams, source code management teams. They have access to the continuous integration master. All the build jobs of integration and all things are run on slaves and masters as well. It depends on the configuration. So, in a typical industry setup, as we saw in the previous diagram, in a typical industry setup, jobs on a CI tool may run on master, it may run on slaves. So it is like a huge network with one node having access to a large number of nodes. So obviously, if a hacker manages to get access to a CI tool, he owns a substantial part of the network, the master node, the slave nodes. The slave nodes may include machines of developers, of build teams, and a lot of different teams, which includes different platforms, Linux machines, Windows machines. In such case, an attacker also owns a substantial part of source code, or at least the build process, even if not the source code, and a lot more things. And obviously, this access could be used for lateral movement, as we'll see. This access, because of the mismanagement of credentials in a Windows networks or in an enterprise network, this access could be used for lateral movement and getting access to much more things. And me, I'm so good that there have been no penetration tests in which if I had access to a CI tool, I've always been a domain admin. So that's true. You'll see a demonstration regarding that thing as well. So I've tested three open source tools, Jenkins, Cruise Control, and Go, and two proprietary tools, TeamCity and Hudson. In fact, Hudson was not tested separately. I will come back to that in a moment. And we will mostly have a look at feature abuse or default configuration or misconfigurations, the things which you actually find exposed to the internet or in internal penetration tests. So we'll stick to that. There are always ways to secure these tools as well, but that is just like 1% of the machines where you'll see the actual secure implementation. Starting with Jenkins, it is obviously if you are new, even new to the CI thing, you must have heard about Jenkins. It is most widely used CI tool. All the testing has been done on version 1.633, which was latest when I started finalizing demonstrations for this talk, maybe 10th of October last month. And yes, Hudson was not tested separately. Hudson and Jenkins are sort of twins, and in the CI fan clubs, it's still a debatable thing that who forked who. Is it Jenkins, like, is the egg came first or the chicken? Was it the Jenkins which forked Hudson, or was it Hudson which forked Jenkins? So you can safely assume that whatever applies to Jenkins applies to Hudson as well. Okay. So some of the security issues with Jenkins. No security in the default installation. Yes, you can always find these default installations exposed even to the internet. So that's pretty lame of guys. I mean, Jenkins is a great tool, but this is really lame to having no authentication in the default installation. In fact, I forgot to write it here. I think the first user which signs up becomes an admin, if I remember correctly. I have to check that. I think that's true even for the latest version. The first user who signs up on an unauthenticated Jenkins instance becomes admin. It needs, you know, some balls to screw it that bad. No protection against brute force attacks. You can, if you have a list of the users on Jenkins, which is trivial to get, you can literally brute force all of them. And in my experience, Jenkins users or any CI tool users, they like to have the same username and password. I mean, if the username is John, the password would be John as well. So it's really trivial to brute force. You can try it anywhere where you have permission to do that, obviously. Okay. Other than that, read the second and third point together. No protection against brute force attacks, no password complexity. That's a recipe for a disaster. You do not enforce any password complexity. You do not have any password history, no password policy. You know, for us, the security folks, these things have been so common that it is baffling to see that an industry tool can really go with that, and that one which is so popular. And on Windows machines, it runs with system privileges. So who uses Windows for Jenkins server? Maybe some do not. But you will always find nodes or slaves on Windows machines, because developers, build team, so many people have slaves or agents of this tool on their machine that you got to have at least 10 to 20% of Windows machines in a Jenkins distributed network. And prior to version 1.580, which was like 8 to 10 months back, any anonymous user can see build outputs, can list users which are present on the Jenkins machine. Still, if you see the publicly available instances of Jenkins, the story is still the same. Even if they have upgraded to the latest versions, they keep it the same. I don't know for what reasons. So there's a reason why I listed these issues first. We are going to assume that because of these wonderful security controls, we are going to assume that we have a low privilege access on all of the CI tools. If you think that this assumption is something not good, then you can try on any of the machines where you have permission, and it is really trivial to get a low privilege access to any of these CI tools. So yes, this is a shocker for us, you know. So abusing build steps. So this is how Jenkins works. If you have a configuration access to any of the build project on Jenkins, which is not a high privilege access, you can add build steps. A build step means when the build is started or configured, is triggered, you can add a build step, which could be a shell command or Windows command or something like that. Due to the distributed nature of Jenkins, it is possible to execute commands and scripts on large number of slaves, as we saw in that network diagram. So this is how it uses. We'll see the live demonstrations as well. You can see that on a slave, we have access as a system. So what makes CI tools a little more bad in terms of security is, for example, in many web consoles, industrial tools, or management consoles, if you have access, even admin access to a web console, it is really not easy to achieve command execution on OS. That is considered a vulnerability in most of the cases, that if you get access to a web console, you can execute commands on the underlying operating system. But that is not the case with CI tools. So this is how a low privileged user called config user can execute commands. I'll show you that this is not an admin user. So this was one part where we can add build steps on a slave. But if you can add build steps on master, it is a disaster. Rhymes good. If you can build steps on a master, it is a disaster. Why? Because you can effectively remove all security on the Jenkins console if you can add build steps on master. You just need to remove config.xml from the Jenkins home, or you can just remove all security by replacing use security true to use security false. And how hard is that to do? We'll see. It's not really hard. On Linux machines, it may be a bit tricky. You'll always find Jenkins instances running as root, but for non-root, it is not possible. But on our dear Windows machines, it's always possible, thanks to system privileges. So it's really screwed up, actually. That means if you have a low privilege access, you can literally destroy the whole intellectual property scenario of an enterprise. Big words, but just try it out. Another thing with Jenkins is it is the capability of storing credentials. For example, if you want to execute a build step by logging into a Unix machine using SSH, or you are storing some credentials, those credentials could be retrieved in clear text. But you must have the ability, again, to add build steps on master, which again depends on the kind of configuration you are trying to test. So passwords, SSH private keys, your passphrases, everything could be retrieved in clear text. This is not my work. I've taken it from this blog. So this is how it looks like. So we need to read three files from the Jenkins master. The first one is credentials.xml. And the master key, and hudson.util.secret. I'm not going to go into details of what went wrong cryptographically, because that is not my forte. You can always read that blog. But I'll show you how this works. Other than these, for Jenkins, some of the bad usage are credentials in clear text are so many times left in build parameters. If you just can have a look at the console output or build log in Jenkins, you may step onto some credentials all the time. And sometimes sensitive files could be found at this. So whatever is the Jenkins URL, go to /usercontent, C capital, and you may get access to some of the sensitive things there. Google Docs for these, please try them on your own risk. Entitled Dashboard Jenkins for Jenkins instances, and Entitled Dashboard Jenkins, in-text manage Jenkins for unauthenticated Jenkins instances which are available on the internet. So use it at your own risk. You can always find sensitive keys, passwords, access to databases, Git credentials, and so many things. And it is ridiculously easy to use, even if it is publicly exposed or not. The most interesting thing I found on public instances was this. Someone left a message on one of the publicly exposed unauthenticated instance. Enable login or your Jenkins dashboard. It can be found with DuckDuckGo. Google sucks. It is still there. I checked it today morning. So, and this one also caught my eye. An authenticated public instance running as root. So that is also pretty screwed up. Okay, so time for live demonstrations. Please bear with me if some of them fail. So I have a Jenkins instance running on one of the local machines. So this is how it generally looks for if you try any of those Google Docs and promise not to do something silly right now. This is how it looks. So these are the build projects. Here you can see the list of users on this machine. And these are the nodes. So we have a master node and a slave node. So we do have some of the projects which have the ability to, which could be executed on master, and some which could be executed on a slave. So let's begin with command execution. So as I said earlier, because it is trivial to brute force into CI tools, we have to assume that we have a non-admin access of a user which has the ability to config builds. So that I have to assume. Again, if it doesn't look good, just try it out on one of the machines you have permission to do. So let's just try this CMD exec. So you can add a build step. This is what we were talking about. You can add a build step, which allows you to either execute a Windows batch command or a Linux shell command. Okay. So let me first just show you. So if I just run, who am I? If I say build now, and then if I go to the console output, you can see that it executes with the system authority on the slave machine. And I use this PowerShell option here because if your slave or your executor is on Windows machine, it is best if you stick to PowerShell to do different evil things. And if it is a Linux node, then of course most of you are really good with Linux. You can write a bash script which can do a lot of things. So for example, let's just try. So why I used PowerShell was, now I'm going to get a reverse shell from that machine using only PowerShell. And that's pretty neat because we'll be able to get a reverse shell with system privileges with a single build. So let's just try that out. I'm going to use PowerCat, which is a netcat port in PowerShell. a very useful tool. And now I'm going to configure it and change the build step with an encoded reverse shell. Okay. So I've already encoded it. It's just a reverse shell. And now if I build this, you can see that we have, because it is a local machine, the shell was really quick. We have a connect back from the Jenkins machine with system privileges from the slave machine. So this is really useful in all the scenarios, rather it be an external engagement or an internal penetration test. This is really, really useful. It comes handy all the time. So that was one of the demonstrations for getting a connect back from a Jenkins slave. Now let's see how we can decrypt credentials. So for that, let me show you the credentials which are already there. So we are going to decrypt these credentials. So we are going to decrypt these things. So let's first see what we are. So what we're trying to do here is this. As we saw in the screenshot, we're trying to read these three files from the Jenkins master. So in this case, the build will run on Jenkins master. So this is where a proper configuration may help you. If this build, if this project called Decrypt Credentials is unable to run on master, then this attack will fail. But unfortunately, most of the times, no one cares where the execution is taking place. But again, if it was unable to execute on the master, this attack will fail. So what we are doing here, we are reading credentials.xml in plain and these two key files as bytes. And then we will rebuild these bytes on the attacker's machine and then pass it on to the Python decrypt script, which someone else wrote, and we'll decrypt the credentials. So if you build it now, so you can see that this is our credentials.xml. This is our master key in bytes. And these are our secrets in bytes. So let's just copy these things and turn them back into usable files. That was our master key, so let me just save a text file called master. Okay, it's already there, I think. Okay, let's just overwrite it. And now we can use some of simple PowerShell scripts I wrote, or any simple Linux command to convert them back to keys. Okay, wrong folder. So we have a master.key now, which is here. So this is our master key for the Jenkins build. Similarly, we can use the convert the Hudson util secret into a key. So let's not do that. I already have that on my Kali instance. Okay, it is up. So the script we are going to use is this one. So the GitHub repository to it is in the slide notes. So it asks for the master key. Okay, let me just. It asks for the master key, the Hudson util secret, and credentials. So let's provide those things. We have master key, this thing, and credentials.xml as well. And you can see that it is really trivial to retrieve saved credentials from Jenkins instance. This is really bad. I don't know why they encrypt it this way. I think this is the worst thing amongst all of the demonstrations. So it's really bad. So that was for Jenkins. Now let's move to TeamCity. So TeamCity is, again, it is a CI tool from JetPrince, I think a German company, that is easy to set up and free for small and medium teams, so generous. It is widely used. I think it's second to, if we count the public instances, after Jenkins, this is the most widely used CI tool. It supports, again, different operating systems. All the demonstrations will be done on TeamCity 9. Build 37059, which again is the latest last month. Some of the security issues with TeamCity: it allows registration of new users by default, and all the registered users get privileges of project developer. So project developer is not a really good privilege. You cannot configure builds. That's good. But still, you can see a lot of things. You can enumerate users. You can see things about projects, the executors, etc. Again, TeamCity does have protection against brute force. So that's another good thing with TeamCity. But again, no password complexity. You can use one character passwords if you want. It also, like Jenkins, it runs with system privileges on Windows machines, whether it be a master or a slave. It is, again, a bad thing. In fact, you'll notice further as well, these things are common to all of the CI tools. It's like a that is why I selected a common abuse set for all these tools. So again, abusing build step. If a user has the ability to add build steps, which a project administrator can, a project administrator is not admin or a high privilege in TeamCity, at least not admin. You can execute commands and scripts on the master or the slaves depending upon the configuration. Sorry. Due to the distributed nature of TeamCity like Jenkins, you can execute things on a very large number of machines using that. So as you can see, that config user is a project admin, and you can add build steps because I'm targeting a Windows machine again, so I'm adding a PowerShell build step there. I'm using agent on master. TeamCity has a concept called superuser. If you have the capability of executing commands by adding build steps on master, you can read the superuser token from this file, teamcityserver.log. That is for TeamCity 9. For TeamCity 8, it was, I think, server.log or something similar. It is well documented. There's nothing which I found out. So you can just read that token, and on the login prompt, you can just use that to log into TeamCity as a super user. And a fun fact here is if you press login 5 times on a TeamCity login page, you can lock out the super user for 1 minute. So to annoy someone or to run a simple denial of service attack, you can just write a script which tries to log in with a blank username and password every 1 minute. And that way you can just lock out the super user. So this is how you read it. You can read the teamcityserver.log file, and you will find the super user token in there. Just use it, I think, without a password on the login machine, and you'll be able to log in as super user. Again, this is extreme privilege escalation. Because CI tools have a different lame set of security controls, this doesn't look very bad. But imagine this in regards with any other web console of anything which is used to manage your hardware devices or your security products. If you can do this sort of extreme privilege change, then that's really bad. And yes, super user. Anyone recognizes this guy? No, he's not famous here? Okay. So super user is much more than admin. So he can, for example, reset admin passwords and do all kind of stuff. You can also read SSH keys from master. Again, for some godforsaken reason, they are stored in plain. So you can read. If you can add a build step on master, that is execute commands there, you can read SSH keys stored with TeamCity in clear text. It's really bad. So this is an example of that. As you can see that we are reading a file. Okay, I'll show you that. And these are the contents of the SSH key which we are reading right now. Other than these, there are some more issues with the TeamCity. Guest login could be enabled. If you go through the publicly available instances, you will see that there are so many public instances which allow guest logins. There's not really something special which you can do with guest, but the starting step of enumerating users for a brute force attack starts from that place. And one special thing which I've seen here is TeamCity allows build parameters to be of type password so that the passwords are not visible in plain. But I've seen so many users using text as the build parameter. So you can always find passwords as well if you have only the read capabilities. Google Docs for TeamCity. InTitle projects TeamCity for all the public instances. InTitle register a new account TeamCity for instances, which provide user registration and a couple of more docs. You can always figure them out as well. The information which I found with TeamCity was even more mind-boggling than what I found with Jenkins. Such things with, I wish I could name those corporations. Think in your mind top 10 software developers in the world, and at least 4 or 5 of them leak things like these. It's not visible, but there on the above screenshot, they are instantiating a test environment with credentials admin with role admin, username test1 with password test1 with no role. I have to admit I saw this thing. This was, there's some new sort of management platform, and this was the address of web portal was in that big black box, and the passwords were there. So this is publicly available. If you can, if you want, you can try it. And here, some very smart game development company was leaking their SA password in their build logs. So these are the kind of things which you get to see when you start enumerating publicly available CI tools. And this is just an example. There are so many things. If you have permission of doing these things, these things should be your first thing to go for in a penetration test. Okay, demo for Team City. So I think I have a Team City on this machine as well. Okay, so I'm already logged in, so you have to log in as a non-privileged user. So this is it's not a non-privileged user, it's a non-admin user with project administrator rights, so that it can build, add build steps or run builds. So if you have a look at this command exec, so you can add a build step here. So I added a build step of PowerShell, and what it does, it is always executed, and it executes who am I. So nothing really neat. We can always use our connect back listener or whatever we want here. And an interesting thing here is we can provide the bitness of PowerShell here. In a later demonstration, we'll see that it is a bit hard to do lateral movement with Jenkins because it starts PowerShell in 32-bit mode. And some of the tools I was trying to use, they just don't run on 32-bit mode. So it's better if you have a team, you can execute it on Team City. In fact, I would like to give props to, I don't want to name the guy, one of the Team City developers approached me on Twitter, and same goes for one of the developers of Go, on when I was tweeting about the documentations, how they documented that these things could be done. And they've even reviewed my slides, and you should assume that there should be some improvements in both Team City and Go because of this thing. I didn't contact anyone because these are all documented features. These are no vulnerabilities. So if you see the build log now, we are again running as system. So quite neat. We can again get system privileges on many machines using this thing. For super user, if you see the command we are using, it's this. We are just grabbing super user authentication token from this file. This token is regenerated every time the service restarts. So if you run this, okay, it's still running. the super user token we can use is, okay, it's yesterday's date, so this is the latest. And as you can see that it says to log in as super user, use an empty username, and this token as a password on the login page. So let's just try that. So now we have logged in as a super user. So quite easy if you can execute, if you can add build steps which execute on master. So a super user has, it's a super user. So many things you can do with it. Let's see if we can read SSH keys in plain. So SSH keys are stored in so this is Team City build directory, this path. It depends on your configuration. You can read all these things in the build logs, which we were looking at right now. / config projects, the project name. For us, the project name is a demo project. Plugin data / SSH keys. So we are reading everything inside the SSH keys directory. Let's run it. And if we see the build log now, you can see that the SSH key was stored in plain text. It's really bad. So that was it for Team City. Go. Go is not the Google's Go. It's an open source CI server by the guys from ThoughtWorks. They were also those who created Cruise Control. So all the demos will be done on Go 15.2.0. Again, latest in 1 month back. Some of the security issues. Again, no authentication in the default installation. That sucks. No protection against brute force attacks. No password complexity, history, etc. Any kind of password policy for passwords. Runs with system privileges on Windows machines. You know, same thing again and again, same thing. They want highest privileges. They don't want to protect passwords. Two of the three we discussed have no default authentication. Again, using the common abuse set, let's see if we can abuse build step. In Go, if you have a pipeline group administrator privilege, which is a non-admin privilege, you can add build steps and execute commands on the underlying host operating system. And yet again, this also supports a distributed build like Jenkins in Team City, so you get access to so many machines in an environment. So this is how you do it in Go. I'll show you a demo of this as well. We just need to add a custom command in the default job or create a new job and add a custom command, and you can run commands with system privileges. If you have the ability to add build steps on a project which can execute commands on master, like Jenkins, you can remove all the security on the Go server. Again, that's really bad. So from a normal user, you can just jeopardize all the security or configuration which was implemented on that machine. The plus point with Go is they do not provide an agent or executor on master by default. So Jenkins do provide that. If you install Jenkins on a machine, there will be an executor on the master. When you install Team City, it asks from the same package if you want to install a slave or an executor on the master, you can. But for Go, you have to shoot yourself. They do not provide an executor on the master by default. You have to install it with a separate package. So that's a plus for them. I know the state of security for these tools is so bad that we have to give marks to someone who has no authentication enabled in default configuration. So this is how we do it. So obviously this could be done in Linux as well. You just need to remove cruiseconfig.xml from the go home directory. That's it. And then you have to restart the go server as well. I think I missed the demonstration for removing security from Jenkins. Okay, I'll get back to that. So yes, that's really bad. Credential storage. Again, the password file option. So Go provides a password file option wherein you can create a password file and provide its URL in the server configuration path to use authentication. But the bad thing about that is that password file requires passwords to be hashed by SHA-1 with no salt, and then they are base64 encoded. So anyone can, if you can get access to that file, you can just use rainbow tables, etc., to brute force those passwords. And another interesting thing which I saw was, now in their documentation, Go provides an example of the password badger. So that I found at least 5 public instances where the password badger was being used. So that sucks actually. I mean, okay. And SSH keys are also stored in clear text on the disk. A user with ability to configure jobs on master can read the keys as well. Again, that's really bad. Sorry. You can always find credentials of this form. Some URL, user password at GitHub. I don't know, maybe there's some reason I found this most of the times in Go servers. But this holds true for Jenkins and TeamCity as well in most of the places. And like other tools, build parameters and environment variables, you can most of the time find something interesting there as well. Google Docs for Go are in title administration Go, in URL Go admin, that is for unauthenticated access, and in title Go login, in URL Go auth, for an instance which asks for authentication. But there are not so many publicly unauthenticated instances. You can count them on fingers, but it's still good to have a feel of how things are configured for Go. Okay, so demo for this thing. Let me just show you one of those because there is. So this is how Go looks like. And let's just not run it. Let's just see the previous one. Okay, maybe so. Let's just move on. So that was Go. Cruise control. Cruise control is an earlier CI solution from ThoughtWorks. It's no more developed actively, but you can find more instances of cruise control publicly available than Go right now. And We'll have no live demonstration of this. There's no need of having a look at that. It has no authentication by default. There are two interesting URLs you may like to use, the URL slash dashboard and slash cruise control. Commands could be executed by adding an exec builder in the schedule category. So if you go to a cruise control instance, you will understand the third point, that how you can execute the command. And you can see the public instances using this Google Doc entitled Cruise Control Dashboard. There are so many of these instances still available. And not only universities, most of the times the instances are for available only from universities. There are some, I don't know what's it with the game development companies. Most of the time CI tools are unauthenticated instances are for game developing companies. They think it's a game or something, maybe. Surely old but not obsolete. Okay, so a demo of a penetration test scenario. We are going to assume that we have a config user level access to Jenkins or any other CI tool. We'll pick Jenkins in this case. And we have an agent or a master or somewhere we have an executor on Windows machines. We'll use PowerShell scripts to enumerate tokens available on that machine, and we'll find a token of domain administrator and reuse that. If you think that this is very simple, try it out in one of the environments where you have permission, and you will be pleasantly surprised. So let me quickly go through this. So what we are going to do here now is, so I'm running out of time, so I'll explain it quickly. I think the scripts are here. I'm going to use invoke token manipulation from the PowerSprite project here. I'm going to pull that script, execute it on the target using this command. And then I have configured, because it's my lab, just for the sake of demonstration, a process is running as a domain admin. It will use its token using this command. And then we will run the get process PowerShell command on the domain controller of my lab. Does that sound fair? Okay. In fact, there's no need to run this right now. Let me just show you the build I tested yesterday. So this is how it looks like. Instead of going for it, let me just show you this. This is how it looks like. I pulled down the script, executed it. So you can see that we have a token of the domain administrator with the process ID 56. So then I again pulled down the script, downloaded it. And for the process ID 56, which was this, I asked my script to impersonate that. And then to execute a process, to execute the command line get process on the domain controller, and here's the result. So it's really not tough to execute commands with domain administrator. This was a very simplified scenario where we know that on a machine there was domain admin logged in. Assume that when there are 25 or 30 or 50 or even 100 slaves running Windows, there would be at least one of the machines where a domain admin left his token. So it's really interesting in that case. So yes, we have the domain admin privileges. Let's quickly talk about this zero-day unserialized vulnerability in Common Collections Java library. This library is used by Jenkins, that is confirmed by the guys who made it famous. I've seen this being used in TeamCity and Go as well, but didn't have time or capabilities to develop an exploit for that. Sorry. Jenkins has an emergency mitigation. Didn't check for past 2 days, but prior to that, there was no fix, only mitigation for that. You can read this blog post from Foxglove Security, which made this famous. And the exploit is picked up from there as well. You can download these. You can see these GitHub repositories from the slide notes to develop the exploit. There's nothing to develop actually. Just need to. What I'm doing here is I'm just using a PowerShell reverse shell, and that is redirected to payload.out, and then I use the exploit from the guys from Foxglove Security to run it on my local machine, and I got a connect back. The only solace with this thing right now is it needs to connect to a higher port. Here you can see that port 63420. So on public instances, you may not be able to test this out. But for internal penetration tests, this thing is going to be your friend for coming 3 to 4 years at least. Okay, so let's skip the demo. A common abuse set. Minimal security by default. Security controls which are common for other tools are missing, like simple password policies. So this is a common abuse set for all the CI tools. You have the ability to run commands and script on operating system, even from non-admin users, with system privileges. If an agent is running on master, all the security is useless, effectively. Insecure storage of credentials, SSH keys, and there are so many public instances of these tools by even the bigger corporations, the Fortune 100s, that makes it really prone to abuse. A couple of defense slides. No build agent or executor should run on the master ever. No build agent executor should run on the master ever. No build agent executor should run on the master ever. So that is the baseline. Restrict privileges which allow configuration of build steps. Pool agents together for specific projects. Secure the administrator's dashboard. It should not be easily available, and anyone should not be able to brute force into it. Expose a CI tool to the internet only if necessary. Do not provide read privileges to anonymous users. They can enumerate your users and run brute force attacks and do a lot of things. Ask users at least not to use their username as password. This is really bad. I see this a lot of time. CI tools developers enforce password policies. A user must install agent or slave explicitly on the master, and if they install it, show them big bad warnings. Do not store credentials and keys in clear text on disk. Please, please don't do that. And assume that your users are idiots and they know nothing about security. And what others are doing, there have been interesting things. Jenkins released a security advisory on 1st of October that the unauthenticated public instances are being abused by malware writers. Someone got a big bounty because Facebook used to run an unauthenticated Jenkins instance, and someone got really hacked, got really bad because, again, of unauthenticated Jenkins. This is some of the previous work. You can just grab the slides and read it. What I have not covered is master agent communication, so no MITM attacks, or compromising integrity of the source code and the build process, web application related vulnerabilities, memory corruption bugs. So if you want to do further work on these things, you can try these things out. So to conclude, CI tools lack many basic security controls. Still, paying attention to their configuration and configuring them properly will reduce the attack surface a lot. And due to the distributed nature of their working, compromise of UI or dashboard, even with non-admin privs, may result in access to a large number of machines in your environment. And running a poorly configured CI tool is like providing a ready-to-use botnet for anyone to exploit. And now this quote may make more sense. And that is it. Questions and feedback.